Hello students, I am Dr. Vipin B. Gavande and welcome to video lecture series in Systems and Mechanical Engineering. In today's video lecture, we are going to discuss about the unit number 5, Introduction to Manufacturing. In this, the first question is the casting. Casting is a manufacturing process used in most of the industries in which the part of desired shape is obtained by pouring the molten metal into the cavity of required shape. That means the cavity of the desired shape is produced and then a molten metal is poured into that cavity. Okay, and finally the casted product is obtained. There are different types of casting. First is called the sand casting, die casting, investment casting, centrifugal casting and the sludge casting. In our syllabus we are only dealing with the sand casting process. Sand casting process consists of two wooden box separated by a center line called the parting line. The upper box it is called as the cope, while the bottom box it is called as drag. Now to form the cavity in the cope and drag, a pattern is used. A pattern is a replica of the final product to be made. A pattern is made from the wood, plastic or the metal. The half portion of the pattern is placed in the drag and the sand is filled around it. The sand is compacted and then the pattern is removed. So half cavity is formed in the drag. Similar half cavity is formed in the cope and then the cope is placed over the drag. Now to get the molten metal into this cavity, we have to form the gating system. The molten metal is prepared in the furnace called the cupola. Then from that cupola it is taken into the bucket called the ladle. From ladle it is first poured into the pouring cup, then it enters into the cone shape portion that is called the downstream. After that it enters into the horizontal passage called the runner, and then through the gate which is at the opening of this cavity, it enters into the cavity formed in the cope and the drag. Now some of the molten metal enters into the riser. Now in riser the molten metal stays for a longer time, so that if there is any deficiency in the cavity, then that molten metal enters into this cavity. Okay. Now if this total cavity is empty, then the final product is the molten metal takes the total portion of the cavity and the complete part is a solid part. If you want the hollow portions into the casted final casted product, then we have to put here the core. So core is used for producing the hollow castings. Okay, so that when the core is placed in the cavity, so molten metal doesn't enter into the portion where the core is placed, and that's why we get the hollow casting, hollow portions in that part. Okay, so the core is used for preparation of the hollow casting. Now once the molten metal enters into the, it fills the total cavity, it is allowed for some time to get solidified, that is called the solidification time. Then it get removed and then the product which is obtained is taken for some manufacturing process. After that it is inspected. That is the final step in our casting process. Okay. There are different advantages and disadvantages of the sand casting process. The first advantages of the casting process, it is the cheapest manufacturing process. We can create complicated shapes using this casting process. The components made from the beetle as well as ductile metal can be manufactured using this casting process. Okay. Economically, we can create small as well as large components. Casting is treated as a primary manufacturing process. We require various other manufacturing process to get the final product. Disadvantages of sand casting process is that we can't produce the components which are heavy, which are very thin, that is the thickness having less than 6 mm. We get various defects during this casting process. Components are brittle. Okay. In nature as compared to the forged components. Surface finish in casting is poor. Manpower and space requirements is very high. Pollutions, because we have to melt the molten metal in the furnace, so it creates the pollution. Risk of injury, because the persons are handling these molten metals, so there is a risk of injury. There are various applications of the sand casting process used for machining weights, automobile parts, then aircraft parts, the casting of various machines, pulleys, railway wagons, wheels and the walls. Now the second question is the define the forging process. Explain open and close die forging with the need sketches. Now forging means what? It is a manufacturing process in which the metal is plastically deformed. The metal deformed plastically only when the metal is heated up to its recrystallization temperature. So at recrystallization temperature, the metal allows us to change its shape and size, and we call that as it is plastically deformed. And how the metal get plastically deformed? We are applying the compressive force on that using the hand hammer, power hammer or the press. Now in forging process, the metal which is heated at recrystallization temperature, we call that as a billet. It is placed between the upper die and the lower die. The upper die, it is connected with the ram, which is operated by mechanical or the hydraulic press, and the lower die it is fixed with the anvil. Now on upper die and the lower die, the cavities of the required shape is produced, and when the compressive force is applied using the ram, the upper die comes in contact with the lower die, the billet gets plastically deformed and it takes the shape of the cavity which is formed on the upper die and the lower die. And after removal of the upper die, we get the final product. Okay, there are two types of forging. One is called as open die forging, another is called as the closed die forging. In open die forging, it is also called as free forging, because this is only used for resizing the billet shape. Okay, resizing and changing the shape of the billet. Now the billet is placed on the lower die, and most of the times the shape of the upper die and the lower die, these are flats. The dimensions will be changed by hammering and stamping the metal through a series of movement until the final dimensions are achieved. Okay, so we require here skilled workers for the open die forging. That is not the case in closed die forging, because the upper die and the lower die contain the cavity of the required shape, the desired shape which we want after the forging process. So the cavities are formed on the lower die and the upper die. Okay, so this is part of what the closed forging. So the difference between the open forging and the closed forging is that in open forging, the upper die and the lower die, these are flat shape, and these are only used for changing the shape and size of the billet or billet. Okay, and we require here skilled workers for doing the open forging. While in case of the closed forging, the shape which we want, it is created in the form of cavities on the upper die and the lower die. Okay, so that we don't require much more machining processes after the closed forging. Now let us see the difference between the open and the closed forging. As we have discussed, the open forging, it is a very simple process, while closed forging it is a complex forging process. It requires simple and inexpensive dies. Open forging and closed forging requires complex and expensive dies. Okay, these are used for small scale production, while the closed forging is used for the large scale production. It is very difficult to hold a close tolerance. Dimensional accuracy, it is very less in open die forging, and dimensional accuracy is maintained in the closed die forging. There is relatively poor utilization of the material in open die forging, while there is the good utilization of the material in closed die forging. This process requires a highly skilled operator, we have already discussed, while the skilled operators are not required for the closed die forging, because the required shape is already made in the open and the upper and the lower die. Okay, the forging process has a less dimensional accuracy. Okay, discuss this one. This forging process has less reproducibility, while the closed forging has better reproducibility. Now this is regarding the die cost. It is less, while it is more in case of the closed forging. In this process, the machining is necessary to obtain the final shape in case of the open die forging, while the machining process not that much it is required in the closed die forging. Now let us discuss the next question, that is define metal forming process. Discuss extrusion and drawing process. Now this is drawing process means it is metal drawing process. Now metal forming is a process in which the components of required shape and size are obtained through the plastic deformation of the metal. Again, there is a plastic deformation of the metal, that means we have to heat the metal up to its recrystallization temperature. Now this metal forming process can be carried out on the metal in a hot or cold condition. That means if the metal is heated above recrystallization temperature, then it is called as a hot working process, and if the metal is heated below recrystallization temperature, then it is called as the cold working process. Now extrusion is the process, is the metal forming process used for manufacturing the long and straight parts of fixed cross section. Now to perform the extrusion process, it consists of the cylinder having the piston arrangement which is connected with the ram. Now the metal billet is placed inside the cylinder at the opening of the die, desired cavity or the shape of the output, desired output product is formed here at the opening of the die. Okay, now when the compressive force is applied using the ram, the billet gets plastically deformed and it passes through the shape which is created at the opening of the die, and then it comes and the extruded part comes out through the die. Okay, so in case of the extrusion process, the compressive force is applied on the billet and the metal gets plastically deformed and then comes out through the opening of the die. So we get the extruded part which is long and straight and of fixed cross section. Okay, now in case of the wire drawing process, the billet is placed here, the opening of the die is of again the shape which we want. So now here it is the only, suppose now if we want the wire, so here the opening of the die is a circle. Now when in case of this wire drawing process we are applying tensile force on the billet, so when we apply the tensile force on the billet, the die apply the compressive force on the billet and the billet get plastically deformed and it comes out through the opening and we get the wire of uniform diameter which is connected on the bull block. So there is a difference, main difference between the extrusion and the wire drawing process is, in extrusion process we are applying compressive force for the plastic deformation of the material or metal, while in case of the wire drawing process we are applying the tensile force or the pulling force on the metal. Okay. Now the next question is the sheet metal working process. So sheet metal working process is the manufacturing the components or the parts from the sheet metal which is having the thickness around 0.1 mm to 6 mm. The sheet metal operations are carried out using the press. So this is also called as what? Sheet metal working process is also called as the press working process. It consists of the die and the punch. So it consists of the die and the punch. The sheet metal sheet is placed over the die. When the compressive force is applied by means of the punch, the sheet metal gets deformed and it takes the shape of the cavity which is formed on the in the die. Okay, so this is the sheet metal working process. The sheet metal working operations are divided into two things, two parts. So one is called metal shearing, where the metal sheet metal get cut, and the forming process where the size and shape of the sheet metal, we are only changing the size and shape of the sheet metal. Okay, now let us see these processes. First we will see the sheet metal shearing operations. So first is the punching process, in which we get the circular hole in the metal sheet using the punch and the die. Okay, now if the metal sheet with the hole is important and the removed part is a scrap, then it is called as punching. And if the removed part is important for us and the sheet metal with the hole is not important, then that process is called as what? Blanking process. Okay, so there is a difference between the punching and blanking, in which the sheet metal with the hole is important, then it is called as punching, and if the removed part is important, then it is called as blanking. Perforating means in punching we get only a single hole. But if you want a number of evenly spaced holes during the punching, then it is called as perforating process. Cutting the sheet metal using the circular rotating circular blades, then it is called as slitting process. Cutting and bending the sheet, the operation is called as lancing. Removing the sheet metal part from the edges, it is called as what? The notching process. Okay, so these are the sheet metal shearing processes or the sheet metal cutting operations. Now in sheet metal forming processes, we have bending, in which the sheet metal get bent by applying the compressive force by the punch. Now when the sheet metal get bent, the bottom part of the sheet metal it get compressed, while the upper part of the metal it get stretched. The center line passing through the center of the sheet metal is called the neutral axis. So bending may be in the form of V bending, where the die and the punch is made up of the V shape. Edge bending, so the sheet metal is bent at the edge by means of the compressive force applied by the punch. U bending, the U cavity is formed on the die, and because of the compressive force of the punch, the U shape sheet metal product is formed at the end. In angle bending, the die is made up of the angular shape. In curling, a hollow circular roll is formed at the edge to the edge of the sheet, which we are using in the vessels and pans or pots in our kitchens for holding the vessels, pans and the pots. In drawing, we are producing three-dimensional hollow shape by plastically deforming the sheet metal. The examples are cups and cans. Okay, so three-dimensional hollow shape produced by the drawing. This is sheet metal drawing. In embossing, we are producing the depressed impressions on the sheet metal, but that is only on the one side. So that is called as embossing. If the depressed impression is on both the sides, then it is called as what? The coining. So this coining process is for preparation of coins, medals, badges, etc. Okay, so impression is on both the sides. Okay, now let's shift to the next question, that is classify the welding processes and explain the shielded metal arc welding. Now welding is a metal joining process in which the workpiece of similar or dissimilar metals are joined together with or without application of pressure, with or without using of filler material. Okay, the filler material helps us for joining the two metal plates. There are two types of welding process. One is called as the fusion or the non-pressurized welding, where we are only using the heat to join the two metals. In pressurized welding, we are using both heat plus the pressure for joining the two metal workpieces. In our syllabus, we are dealing only with the shielded metal arc welding or electric arc welding process. In electric arc welding process is a non-pressurized welding process in which an electric arc is produced between the electrode and the workpiece, and we are using here electrode as a filler material. Okay. Now the various components used in the electric arc weldings are the power source, electrode holder. We have work table on which the metal workpieces are placed. We have the electrode and we have the cables. Now in electric arc welding, if the supply is DC, the negative terminal is connected to the electrode and the positive terminal is connected to the workpiece. Okay, now to start the electric arc welding process, the workpieces are placed on the work table and the electrode is striked over the metal pieces. Now when there is a contact between the electrode and the metal workpieces, there is a generation of electric arc. So as soon as the electric arc is generated, there is a generation of huge amount of the heat, and which is in the range of 1000 to 2400 to 4000 degrees Celsius. Okay, this huge amount of heat is generated because of the generation of the arc between the metal workpieces and the electrode. The electrode is taken up and a distance of 3 to 6 mm is maintained between the metal workpiece and the electrode. Now the metal electrode is the metal electrode is now only placed over the the metal the electrode is only placed over the workpieces, and because of the generation of the arc between these two, the metal pieces get melt, and there is a generation of the molten pool, and because of that there is a formation of the bond between the two metal pieces. Okay, along with the melting of the metal pieces, there is melting of the electrode also, which also help in forming the bond between the two metal pieces. Okay, now because of the generation of the high amount of heat, there is a formation of the shielded gas which prevent the entry of impurities from the environment into the molten pool. Okay, so this is the working of this is the process of the electric arc welding. Okay, now advantages of electric arc welding: it does not require external pressure, so this is the fusion welding process. Arc welding is the most versatile welding process which can be used to join thick as well as thin section. It can be used to join the complicated shapes also. It is one of the least expensive welding process, and this setup is portable. Okay, so you can take this setup to anywhere. Disadvantage is what? The process is very slow. We require skilled workers here, and it is subjected to defects such as slag inclusion, cracking, etc. Now application includes fabrication of windows and door frames, window grills, structural parts, etc. Construction of the bridges, transmission towers, electric towers, buildings, etc. Manufacturing of boiler, nuclear reactor, storage tank, pipelines, work, etc. Okay, so these are some of the applications of the electric arc welding. Okay, now the next topic is the machine tool. Machine tool is a power driven machine used for making the components of a desired shape, size, accuracy and surface finish by removing the material from the workpiece. Okay, so various types of machining operation can be performed on the machine using the machine's tool. The types of machine tools include the lathe machine, drilling machine and the milling machine. We'll discuss this all three machines one by one. Lathe machine, we will first discuss the lathe machine. So lathe machine is a machine in which the tool rotates the workpiece about an axis of the rotation to perform the various cutting operations. So this is the workpiece which is rotating here, and various operations are performed on the rotating workpiece. Now this is the block diagram for our lathe. Now let us see the different parts of our lathe machine. Now the lathe machine consists of this is called the headstock. The headstocks includes the drive mechanism, which is in the form of the gear, which consists of the electric motor and the belt and pulley mechanism. So various types of the speed we can obtain on the hollow shaft, that is called the spindle. Okay, so the drive mechanism provides different types of the speed variations on the spindle. Okay, now the spindle is connected with the chuck. The different types of chuck is used is 3-jaw chuck or the 4-jaw chuck. Okay, the chuck is used for holding the workpiece. Okay, so this is 3-jaw chuck, 1, 2, and 3 jaws. And we have here the key for holding the workpiece in the chuck. Okay, now after that the next part is called the carriage. Okay, now in carriage we have it is called the saddle. Okay, which slides on this guideways. Okay, so here these are the guideways on which this saddle slide. Okay, the another part, it is called as the apron, where The apron is the mechanism of the carriage by using which we can apply the manual or the automatic movement to this carriage. Okay, so that is called the apron. Now the next part is called what, the cross slide. So to give the tool to move the tool in the radial direction, so this direction, so the cross slide is used. So this is called the cross slide. Okay, by rotating this wheel we can move the tool in the radial direction. Now this part is called as the compound rest, which is mounted on the cross slide, and the compound rest is having the tool post. Okay, this is called as tool post. The tool post means we can fix our tool in the tool post. Okay, so here this is the tool post, and now let us see this tool here. Let's see the tool. Okay, so single point cutting tool is mounted on the tool post. Okay, so these are the different components of our carriage. So the carriage consists of the saddle. So this is the saddle which moves on the guideways. Then it is having the apron, which is the mechanism for the movement of this total carriage. Then we have the cross slide, which gives the radial movement to the tool direction, and then afterwards we have the tool post on which the single point cutting tool is mounted. The next portion is called as the tailstock. So this is our tailstock. Okay, this is called the dead center. Okay, and this is our wheel. This is for the handle for removing this dead center, and we can insert here boring tools also. Okay, which is operated by means of this wheel. Okay, which is on the back side. Okay, so we can give the movement to the dead center using this wheel. Okay, now at the bottom of this we have these two rods. One is called the lead screw, and another is called the feed rod. The feed rod is used for giving the automatic movement to the carriage. The lead screw is used when there is the threading operation is to be performed on the workpiece. Okay, so this is all regarding the information regarding the construction and working of your lathe machine. So main components are headstock, which includes the drive mechanisms in the form of electric motor, and the belt and cone pull, the belt assembly of belt and cone pulleys. The speed variation is given to the hollow shaft part of the spindle. The spindle is connected with the jug which hold the workpiece. The next part is called the carriage, which consists of the saddle which moves on the sideways. Apron is a carriage mechanism which is used for giving manual and automatic movement to the carriage. Then the cross slide is mounted on the saddle, which gives the radial direction to the tool. The compound rest is mounted on the cross slide, and the tool post is mounted on the compound rest. Tool post hold the single point cutting tool for various operations. Okay, to be performed on the workpiece. The next part is called the tailstock, which is having the dead center. If the workpiece is of longer length, then it is fitted between the chuck and the dead center. Okay, we are having the bed, which are having the two legs. The bed is generally made up of the cast iron, because the cast iron absorbs the most of the vibration. So the cast iron is the bed is made up of the cast iron. Okay, these are all the components. The lead screw and the feed rod. Feed rod is used for giving the automatic movement to the carriage, and the lead screw, when it is engaged, this is used for the threading operations. Okay. Now let us discuss the turning operations on the lathe machine. The turning is, it is a lathe operation in which the diameter of the workpiece is reduced by removing the material from the workpiece by keeping its length constant. Okay, so the workpiece is fitted in the chuck, and in this operation the diameter of the workpiece is reduced by removing the material. So the depth of cut is given in radial direction, so the tool moves in this direction, so that is the depth of cut, and the feed is given in axial direction, so along the axis of the workpiece. So feed is along the axis of the workpiece, and the depth of cut is perpendicular to the axis of the workpiece. Okay. The next operation is the taper turning operation, in which the diameter of the workpiece is removed, but the depth of cut is given in radial direction, and the feed is given in angular direction. So that is the difference between the plane turning operation, in which the feed is given parallel to the axis of the workpiece, while in taper turning the feed is given in angular direction. Okay, at certain angle with the axis of the workpiece. Eccentric turning means reducing the diameter of the workpiece, but by keeping the offset between the axis of the workpiece and the axis of the workpiece and the axis of the product form. Okay, so it is the process of removing the material from the cylindrical surface of the workpiece to reduce its diameter about an axis offset from the axis of the workpiece. So this is the original axis of the workpiece, and this is the axis of after removing the material from the workpiece. So there is an offset between these two axes, that's why this is called an eccentric turning. Okay. Now let us discuss the second machine. The second machine is a drilling machine. Drilling machine is a machine tool used for making the hole in the workpiece by forcing the rotating tool into the stationary workpiece. So you have to remember here, in case of drilling machine, the tool is rotating and the workpiece is stationary. While in case of the lathe machine, the workpiece is rotating and the tool is stationary. Okay. Now the tool used for making the cylindrical hole in the workpiece is a multi-point cutting tool. It is called as the drill. So the tool which is used in drilling machine is a multi-point cutting tool, while the tool which is used in the lathe machine is a single-point cutting tool. The drill is made up of hard and strong material like high carbon steel. Drill is a cylindrical bar with helical flutes and radial cutting edges at one end. Okay. Now let us see the construction of the drilling machine. Now this is called the sensitive drilling machine, which consists of the base. On the base we have the column, in which we have the screw, and the work table. It is connected with this column. Okay. Now on the work table we can put the workpiece. Workpiece is fitted on the work table. The work table can be moved up and down using the column using the table clamp, and the distance is adjusted. Okay. Then the next portion is the drilling head, in which we have the spindle which is rotated by means of the electric motor. The chuck is connected with the spindle. It gets rotation from the spindle, and the drill bit is fixed in the chuck. So the drill bit is rotated because of the rotation of the chuck spindle, and which will give the rotation from the electric motor. Okay. Now to perform the drilling operation, a marking is made on the workpiece, and the distance is adjusted between the two markings. Okay, the tip of the drill and the marking on the workpiece. Now a drill feed handle is rotated so that the rotating drill, it enters into the workpiece, it removes the material, and the drilling operation is performed. Okay, so this is regarding your drilling machine. Now let us see the drilling operations on the drilling machines. We already seen, to perform the drilling operations we have to do the marking on the workpiece, and we have to maintain the distance between the top the tip of the drill and the point at which we want the circular pole. Okay. Now using the drill bit, drill feed handle, using the this drill bit handle, when we rotate this drill bit handle, the drill bit it enters into the workpiece and it removes the material from the workpiece and the drilling operation is performed. Okay. So this is regarding the drilling machine and the operations that is performed on the drilling machine. Okay. So it is only the drilling operation. Okay. Okay. Now let us discuss now the third, the machine tool, that is the milling machine. Milling machine is a machine tool used for removing the undesirable material from the workpiece by feeding the workpiece past a rotating multi-point tool called a milling cutter. So milling is used for producing flat, helical and contour surfaces and also for cutting gears and screw threads of various types. Okay. Now the construction and working of the milling machine, so it consists of the base on which the column is mounted. The column enclose the electric motor and the rotation is transferred to the spindle. From spindle the rotation is transferred to the arbor, and the multi-point cutting tool, that is called the milling cutter, it is mounted on the arbor. So as the arbor rotated, the milling cutter starts rotating. Okay, or the milling cutter gets the rotation from the arbor, which is rotated because of the spindle, and the spindle is rotated by means of the electric motor, which is fixed in the column. Okay. Now here also, similar to the drilling machine, the work table is connected with the column, and there is an adjustment. There is also the adjustment for moving the work table up and down, and taking the workpiece to the towards the milling cutter. Okay, so the here in this milling machine, the tool is stationary. Okay, that means it is fixed. The tool is rotating here, but it is fixed on the arbor, and the workpiece is fed toward the milling cutter. Okay, so there is a movement of the workpiece here, not the tool, that is milling cutter. Okay. Now the operation, explain the milling operations on the milling machine. So when there is a question, explain milling operations, we have to explain the up milling and the down milling. So there is a basic difference between the up milling and down milling. So here the milling cutter is rotating in anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so here you have to make the correction. In up milling, the cutter is rotated anti-clockwise. So here there is a anti-clockwise. Okay, the cutter is rotating anti-clockwise, and the workpiece is fed toward, that is from right to left. Okay, so that means against the direction of the rotation of the cutter. Okay, so in up milling, so the main and basic difference between the up milling and down milling is the direction of rotation of the cutter. In up milling, the cutter is rotating anti-clockwise, when the workpiece moves from left to right. In this type of milling, the tool spins against the direction of the feed. Okay. In this milling process, the cutting chips are carried upward by the tool. Okay. So these chips are carried upward by the tool. And in case of the down milling, the milling cutter is rotating clockwise, and that means along the direction of the movement of the workpiece. So workpiece is moving from right to left, and the cutter is also moving clockwise direction. Whereas in up milling, the cutter is moving in anti-clockwise direction, and the feed is given from left to right in opposite direction. So the chips are moving upward here, and the chips are moving downward here in down milling. Okay, that's why the names are given up milling and down milling. So up is for the chips are moving upward, and down milling means the chips are moving downwards. Okay, so you have to remember the direction of rotation of the cutter. Okay, and the direction of the feed is same here from right to left, but the direction of direction of rotation of rotor is different in both the cases. In up milling it is anti-clockwise, while in down milling it is clockwise. Now let us discuss about the construction and working of the CNC machine. Now this is the block diagram for the CNC machine. The CNC machine means it is computer numerical control machining. It is a machining process where the computers run the programs and control remaining machine components during the machining operations. Now it consists of the input device, the display unit, then machine control unit, driving system, the machine tool, feedback device. Okay, so the input device consists of the computer where the G codes, the program is given in the form of G codes and M codes. The display unit uses all the processes which is happening in the on the CNC machine. The G codes and M codes programming it is read in the machine control unit, and after decoding that programs, the signals are sent to the driving system. The driving system gives the signals to the various driving mechanisms such as motors and the tools and on the machine tool, and everything on the machine tool it runs automatically. Now the feedback of the movement of the tool, the position of the workpiece, and all related information regarding the operations are sent in the form of the feedback to the feedback device to the machine control unit, and which is sent to the display unit. Okay, if there is any correction in the programs or other, we can easily identify by observing the feedback on the display unit. Okay, so this is the working, the construction and working of the CNC machine. The detailed descriptions you just read it from here. So this is simple one. Okay, driving system, feedback system, and then these are the advantages over the common lathe machine. So it can produce jobs with the highest accuracy. Highly skilled operator is not required to operate a CNC machine. Okay, that is required in our normal CNC machine. Operators can easily make the changes, and it has the capability to produce complex designs, which is not possible on the normal lathe. The cost of the CNC machine is very high. That is a disadvantage. The parts of the CNC machines are expensive. Maintenance cost is very high, and the tools used for this machine is also costly. So the disadvantages are major regarding the cost. Okay, so this is regarding our CNC machine. Okay, now the last question is on the write a short notes on the micro machining. Now as a result of the current trend toward the product of miniaturization, there is a demand for development in micro manufacturing technologies in order to have the better quality products and cheaper, more efficient and effective processes. So so now we are now going for the miniaturization process, where we are producing the products of very minor size as compared to the size of that product available today. Okay, so miniaturized products and components in the range from few hundred micrometers to few micrometers size are becoming common and widely used in our daily life. The simple example is our televisions we are using today. The size of the televisions we are using some 5-10 years back and now, so that is because of this micro machining. So all the electronics components now we have miniaturized that one. So we have reduced the size of that particular part, but it functions as the same with capacity even in the small size. Okay, so that is the main advantages of micro machining. Okay. Now the second process is the additive manufacturing system. Additive manufacturing system means we are adding something and we are producing the final product. While we have seen in machine tools, we have removed the material from the existing metal, and then we have formed the final product. But in additive manufacturing, we are adding the material and then we are producing the final product. Now here there is a deposition of this material, deposition of material in the layers. Okay, the best example is a 3D printing process. So 3D printing is an additive manufacturing process in which the three-dimensional solid objects are produced from the digital pipe. Okay. Now, what is the process that is carried out in the 3D printing process? So, first of all, we have to prepare the 3D model. So, you can prepare this 3D model in any CAD software. Now, that 3D model it is converted into STL file and then it is fed into the it is given to the 3D printer software. Okay. Now, after giving that 3D the file in the STL file to the 3D printer, then one type of the modeling process that is used is a fused deposition modeling, in which the in which a plastic filament or metal wire is unwound from a coil and supplies material to the extrusion nozzle, which can turn the flow and off. So here we are using plastic filament. So plastic filament is used in the fused deposition modeling. So which is wound here, and then it enters into the heater element. So when this plastic filament it enters into the heater element, it gets plastically deformed, and when it comes through the nozzle, it follows the programming which we have done on the software provided with the 3D printing software, and in a similar way the material which is coming out through the nozzle it deposits the material layer by layer, and we get the final 3D product. Okay, so like this, the 3D three-dimensional product is formed using the 3D printing 3D printer. Okay, so this is our 3D fused deposition modeling. Okay, so after that we have to remove the part, we have to do the post processing. So this is our 3D printing process. Okay, the third process is reconfigurable manufacturing system. Is a system used by the manufacturer that emphasizes the importance of being able to change and evolve rapidly in order to adjust its productivity and capacity and functionality. That means if a sudden change occurs in the market, the reconfigurable manufacturing system changes in response, allowing the company to produce product or goods in an efficient manner. Okay, so if there is any change occurs in the market with respect to the product, we have to change the production as per the requirement in the market. So that is reconfigurable manufacturing system is deals with. Okay, now there are six characteristics of this RMS. First is the modularity, the inherability, customized flexibility, scalability, convertibility, and diagnosability. Okay, so this is the explanation. This is the simple one. Okay. The last thing is the Internet of the Things. The Internet of Things is a network of smart devices that connect and communicate via the Internet. Okay. The key to the IoT is the interconnectivity of devices which collect and exchange the information through embedded software, cameras and sensors which sense these lights, sound, distance and movement. Okay. Smart devices operate automatically or are controlled and monitored remotely. Okay. Now, what we require here? We require sensors. So sensors, they collect very minute data from the surrounding or environment, and then we require connectivity. Now how we get the connectivity? So connectivity is from the cloud infrastructure or the IoT platform. Then once all the information it goes to the cloud, then it process that we require the data processing. So that is carried out using the big data analytics engines, and once the analysis is done, so then it is transferred to the user interface. Okay, so we get some feedbacks on the what we have to what the user have to do as on the basis of the notification received from the data processing unit. Okay, so this is the same thing. I have given you the examples that the suppose you left for some vacation, and if you forgot to close the lights, fans, AC from your home, so you can you will get a notification on your mobile that these appliances are running in our home, so you can close it from anywhere using the IoT systems. Okay, so that is the importance of our Internet of Things. Nowadays we are now this is the emerging area. Most of the engineering streams, they are now using now this Internet of Things. Okay, so this is a very important topic. So on these things we get, so on these four topics we'll get the short notes. So just prepare this theory, that means on micro machining, the additive manufacturing, in which the 3D printing is very important question, then the reconfigurable manufacturing systems, WIS, and the last one is the Internet of Things. Okay, thank you very much and best of luck for your examination.